C4 and Brian Neiman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
We're pleased to be joined by the mayor of the city of Baltimore, Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott. First of all, Happy New Year. Good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Hey, Mr. Mayor.
Good New Year. Happy New Year to both of you gentlemen. Good morning.
Good morning. Well, we did start the new year off, though, Mr. Mayor, in a way that we kind of had a lot of 2022, and that is juveniles, those under the age of 18 being victims of gun crimes, and everything from the shooting over at the Popeyes outside of Evanston High School to what happened at Benjamin Franklin High School with some teenagers shot, and then yesterday a 15-year-old that was wounded. And Mr. Mayor, a lot of people want to know, when are we going to elevate? I know you have been talking about going into schools with your program, looking at how to deal with conflict resolution, but when are we going to really elevate the issue of juvenile violence that seems to be really out of control right now?
Well, you know, I'm going to continue to elevate it, C4, and I can only speak for myself and speak for what I'm going to continue to do, to not only elevate it, but to talk about it in the true sense of what's going on with these young people, right? I know infamously, you know, I may have used some words that my grandmother wouldn't have wanted me to use on air a few weeks back, but it was the truth. And we have to understand that when you're talking about these young people and the things that they are getting into these conflicts over are not things that you, Brian, or myself didn't get into conflicts over when we were their age, right? But it resolved in a different way. Even if it resulted to some kind of physical altercation, it was never involving a gun. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have to do the both and with these young people. That's why, like you just said, we're going to be going deeper into the schools doing that conflict resolution. That's why we're supporting folks like Uncle T, who's doing that work in the schools. Of course, We Are Us, who continues to do that work. But then on the flip side, we also have to focus on how these young people are getting these guns, right? And we know you and Brian both have heard me talk about ghost guns in particular, but young people are getting their hands on those because they can very easily. They can just go online and order it, which is why we sued that particular company that is usurping Maryland's gun laws, where we want people to be able to, who can legally own a gun, own it the right way, to put guns in the hands of people that shouldn't have them, including young people. And then when you see and hear and you read, as I know you do, Steeple and Brian, the reasons, once these cases go to court, what people are shooting each other over, right? It literally is stupid stuff. And when you think about that, when people are doing it over Instagram posts because some girl left one guy and went to another, those are things that we truly have to understand that we have to hold people accountable for when they do those things and make sure that there's swift and certain circumstance consequences, as we always say. But we also have to figure out, how in the hell did we get to a point, not just in Baltimore, not just in Maryland, but in this country, that's the kind of things that people are resorting to violence over. And when you think about the heartbreaking story that, of course, I've known for a while, but now everyone knows, that, you know, a little 8-year-old baby's brother got charged with his murder, right?
Mm-hmm.
That says a lot about our society. That's not a city or a county thing or a Baltimore thing or a Maryland thing. That's an American issue that we have to raise up, because that kind of stuff is happening everywhere. We care the most, obviously, about what happens here. And that's also the reason why I was so angry with some members of the media not named WBAL or WBAL Radio last night, because I knew that they knew what had happened. But there's no way that we're going to stand there and see, let a family find that out live on the street when they're standing to the right of us. We got to have some decencies when you're dealing with people who are dealing with a trauma of going to have to bury a baby like that.
Well, let me kind of piggyback on that. And that is, you know, I think I've counted 11 juveniles shot already this year. I mean, that's one every other day in Baltimore. The problem is, obviously it's a massive problem. But another problem is that I haven't made any arrest. And I know this has been a big problem, but why aren't we having any success? Somebody has to know who is responsible for some of these shootings, especially at the one outside of Edmondson, right? Why is there still such a big struggle to get people to come forward to help police try to solve these crimes?
Yeah, bro. We know, what I'll say without going into too much detail, we know that our detectives are the best, right? And they go out and they make these arrests and they make these cases. But oftentimes we know that they are still some hesitancy in the community. We know in that case in particular, they are working the leads on that case. We have two of our finest detectives on that case. But we know what happens is folks are afraid sometimes to say something. Folks don't want something to happen to their family members, right? We have all of those things continue to happen, which is why you see me and other folks fighting for more when we talk about witness relocation and all those kind of services that we know we need to have happen in the city of Baltimore consistently. But we also know, Brian, that when you're talking about these kind of issues, and this is why you see folks like myself, the brother We Are Us, we also have to make sure that there is community accountability, personal accountability for the things that we know need to happen in the city and inside of these communities where folks just feel like they can do anything. But I will say, though, even, and we talked about this a lot, so last year, we had a very high record of gun arrests. So far this year, we're even at 31% above that. So we know that they're going to continue to build these cases. I have no doubt in my mind that they're going to be able to bring those people to justice, hand them over to our new state's attorney or our U.S. attorney, whichever one of them, and once the case is made, decides where it should go, and then send these people down the line. But I will say this, Brian, the folks that are out there that know, you have to do the right thing. I don't care if it's your son. I don't care if it's your daughter. I don't care if your husband, boyfriend, fiance, whoever. You cannot, and we cannot, have a culture where we allow people that we know kill babies, shoot women. You know, we had people in the past shoot and kill pregnant women and let them sleep in your house, let them sleep on the couch. Because if they did that to that person, you better wake the hell up. Because if the pressure gets on them and they feel like they have to, they'll do it to you too.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott is on board with us this morning. And, Mr. Mayor, since you mentioned him, State's Attorney Evan Bates has said he wants to go to Annapolis and get them to help him to strengthen the ability to have some minimum types of sentences on those under the age of 21, really under the age of 18. Would you be supportive of that? What he is saying is he's not going to just be lock him up and throw the key away, but in certain instances, he wants the flexibility to be able to apply this. Could you see yourself supporting him on that?
Yeah, no. So the state attorney and I have been, we had some initial talks about that. He and I, what I will say is he and I both agree because this is one of the things that I have been talking to him about extensively even before he got in office. And even with now duly sworn in Governor Moore about how the entire juvenile system in our state has to continue to be looked at and reformed, right? Because you and I, Brian, we know that the traditional juvenile system doesn't work, but we also, the adult system doesn't work for juveniles, but we also know that nothing doesn't work, right? And you know, C4, and you know, Brian, very well that if you're arrested, you know, for carjacking with a gun, and we serve a warrant for you for Baltimore County, and then you plead guilty, and then the next month you're back in Baltimore City and you're doing the same thing and we arrest you again, something's wrong. That's not working, right? And I'm frustrated about it. I get real frustrated because people ask me why the people are back out, and, you know, I have to turn into C4 and say, well, that's we have to talk to our other partners on the other side. We're not the folks that are working through that portion. And it's not working for anybody, right? When you have guardians and other folks that we've seen in the media say, listen, I need help. Don't send them home. And we do it anyway. And they do it anyway. We have to figure out what works. We have to build systems that not just work with those individuals, especially we're talking about young people, but more importantly, also work with their families, C4, because you know very well, if you send a young person home to a family where there are so many issues that young person at 14, 15, 16 is the person that's bringing home the most money, if we don't deal with that, we're going to continue to see this cycle. So I've already said, and I said publicly when we announced our Annapolis agenda, that working with all of our partners, the state's attorney, our fabulous General Assembly, led by the Senate president, who we know is a great leader, led by our speaker, who we know is a great leader, and our governor and our lieutenant governor, to really look at how that system needs to evolve so that there's something. We have to fix it.
All right. We are more than a week now since the Squeegee Collaborative Plan started. How do you think it is working so far?
Well, listen, this is just the beginning, and we know that there are a lot less. When you go out there, there are a lot less folks that are out there doing the initiative. We, like I said before, we knew that it wasn't just going to immediately end on January 10th. We've been very clear. But what we're trying to do is go deeper and further and make sure that we're dealing with the issue in its entirety, right? Our enforcement in the disallowed zones is focused on making sure that Squeegee workers and the drivers both are held accountable. But we're not, as you heard from the state's attorney here, and I are in lockstep on this, we're not just going out and locking people up right off the bat. So we're at the point now, Brian, where much like we did when we turned on the cameras on I-83, where we give a warning period and say that after this period, it will no longer be a warning. It will move to the citation period. But most folks have been taking heed to it anyway. We're going to continue to be out there doing the enforcement. We're going to continue to go out there offering and giving these young people recognized jobs. I got to thank while you give me an opportunity, I need to thank everyone that's involved in the collaborative. But I want to lift up specific businesses that have been great in dealing with this and helping us. T. Rowe Price, Under Armour, Care First, and their CEO, Brian Pinnick, who has really dug deep in. If you haven't seen the video of us discussing this at our last Squeegee Collaborative event, where we had hundreds of young people behind applying for jobs, getting the resources they need there, hear what Brian was saying about that. That's the kind of partnership, and that partnership between the city, the business community, philanthropy, and the actual impact of the community itself is why this is working. It's going to work better than any other plan to deal with this issue that's been here since at least 1985.
So there have no citations been handed out then? Is this like a month and then they're handed out?
It's a warning period. We told everyone that January would start with the warning period, and then when we move into the next month, just like we did, well, actually we gave 6 months or whatever for the speed cameras. Right. It's just like that build-up period.
And yes, sir. Just if you could clarify, what is the citation? Like, is it a fine? Is it, you have to,
it's a criminal civil citation. It's a fine. But again, remember, again, the key thing, Brian, is that we want the young people or the younger people, because we know some of them are adults. It's a little different when it's young students. We're taking them back. That's something else, too, that's very important. We now have the city schools, and I know C4 will remember this, where we now have folks, which in my day, in his day, we would call truancy officers, that are actually out there working with my folks from the African American Male Engagement Office, from BPD, and we're taking these young people back to school and getting them where they need to be as well. So it's obviously different for young people versus adults.
Right.
The citations can only be given, to the parents, et cetera, but it's a criminal citation. But if you take this information, if you participate in the things that we would want you to do, if you're off that corner, then obviously we don't have to go that route.
Mayor Brandon Scott, we have a notice here from the president of Fraternal Order of Police, Sergeant Mike Mancuso, saying that yesterday 4 Baltimore City police officers walked in the Southwest Police District and resigned. And a lot of it has to do, they say, for better working conditions, things like that. But he highlights the fact how short we are, Sergeant Mancuso just says here, on police officers. As we head into 2023, what is the morale inside the police department? Are you concerned when you have officers just walking in and resigning, as apparently Sergeant Mancuso is saying here?
Well, thank you, C4. It's the first that I've heard of it. We know, listen, I talk to our police officers each and every day. And we know that being a police officer is hard. It's extremely hard. Watch, we're extremely grateful for the work that those women and men do each and every day here in Baltimore and around the country. But we also know it's become even harder over the past few years. We know that people resign. We know that we're going to continue to go out and hire folks. I met a young lady last night at the governor's ball who was elated to tell me that her son had now just join, and it's going to be in our academy as a trainee, a cadet in our academy. We're going to continue to do things, as you know, the incentives that I've offered, the things that we're putting in place to make sure that we continue to try to keep, retain, and attract folks into BPD. And you know that I know Sergeant Mancuso very well. I consider him a friend. It will be open and always talking with them about how we can improve. And you can see even in our agenda in Annapolis, two of the biggest things that we lifted up is improving conditions for police officers in the city by renovating two of our police districts.
I think I went back to the shooting at Edmondson. I know you're very upset with a Popeyes, put a lot of responsibility on Popeyes or any business not to serve kids during school hours. Yet, you know, you just said, and we all have seen kids out squeegeeing during school hours. Shouldn't government have that same responsibility? I mean, if you see a kid, if you're not supposed to serve a kid during school hours, why should they be able to be on the street?
This is the truth, and I haven't had the opportunity to say this publicly. So the reason why I was so upset with that particular business and a couple of businesses there, and I know the C4 knows that shopping center very well, which we weren't in planning to say it that way, which is why my administration, since the day I got here, has been working to try to get that shopping center in the hands of someone who truly cares about that community. And we know that we're going to do it, and we know that everyone knows now that we as a city are going to be allocating $8 million towards renovating that shopping center that has been owned by someone who doesn't care about that community for decades. But that day, Brian, individuals from Emerson High School were over there working, government paid employees, to get those young people back into school while, and this happened. Everybody can be doing what they're supposed to do, and tragedy still happens. That Principal Perry himself, the councilman for that area himself, the staff, the coaches, the assistant principal, have been over there talking to that business and another one in particular, going over there every day to push young people back. They were doing what they were supposed to do. The government had just fined that location for that very reason. Everybody can be, there's responsibility on every single level. But when they were there and doing that work that day, the truth is that it wouldn't have happened that day at that time, right? And that's the frustration, if they were doing the right thing.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott, next Tuesday would be 1 year since the tragedy at Strick Street, where we lost 3 Baltimore City firefighters, a fourth was injured. Brian and I have had on the president of the Baltimore City Firefighters Union and the president of Fire Officers Union talking about the line of duty death report, the report that came out recently, you know, recommending things. And they said your administration has been doing some of these things. We know that the fire chief, Niles Ford, resigned. What about the vacant buildings issue? That's the one thing they say that still is an issue, of making sure that we deal appropriately with these vacant buildings.
Well, I think we agree. And, you know, those two gentlemen, a friend of mine, Rich Langford, is my Mervo Mustang brother, and Josh is a great friend as well. And the three of us communicate consistently. Again, as you can see, we know, C4, we've had issues with vacancies in the city longer than I've been breathing oxygen. But we have continued to raise the level up on that. We, again, this is one of our focuses in Annapolis to get some help there. We even working with some, I can't talk about it yet, some other folks about how we can do a bigger push. We've had a great working relationship with the state on dealing with the vacants. We know that we're thankful for Delegate Boyce, who's going to be introducing legislation that we've added to the mayor's package in Annapolis to allow Baltimore, like other cities around the country, to tax those vacant properties and homeowners at a higher rate so that we can either get them on the ball, C4, or get the property out of the hands. Mm-hmm. This is why we now have a specific docket at the circuit court, because we have asked for that to speed up the interim and receivership process, working on this issue in every single solitary way.
So how was your day yesterday? Annapolis last night, the significance of it, obviously. What'd you think?
It was a great day. It was a great day. And when you think about where we now have this alignment that you only get once in a generation or once in a lifetime, when we have a governor now that understands the city, that really truly wants to to be a partner with the city, that lives and breathes the city, that chose this city as his home. When you have a new attorney general who we know loves Baltimore City, when we have a comptroller who lives here and chose the city as a home, when we have a lieutenant governor who now is someone who's going to be representing everybody in Maryland, where no one will be left behind, that we want to work in true partnership. But as I said last night to the rest of the country, the eyes of the country or Maryland, and there should be, because here, Brian, we don't break glass ceilings, we blow them up. And if they want to see how you can truly work in a representative democracy, work across the aisle, have leaders that look like everybody, look to Maryland. We're going to do what we always do and lead the way.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott, we're going to leave it here, but I do want you to know that we are going to be having your Muncie director, Shantae Jackson, on a regular basis, talk about GVRS and kind of how we're expanding the GVRS outside of Western District into other districts on a regular basis. And I just want you to know, as we have her on, we won't bring up the issue of the crab cakes that we're still waiting for, Brian and I, here at the studio. We'll be very friendly. We'll be very friendly.
If he chooses to give you one, Brian, that's fine. I'm going to send it to the studio one day, y'all be good.
I just want to make sure you know we're going to be friendly to your staff when they come on.
Neither one could beat a Rundle, so we all know that. You guys wouldn't even take that bet.
Actually, I think we eliminated a Rundle in the playoffs a couple years ago, but we'll leave that alone, Brian. No.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
State champs.
Thank you, gentlemen.
I appreciate it.
State championship game. Lost. But.